There's lots of different specialties in computer science and in software engineering, but in America, there's one area in particular that seems to attract an awful lot of attention, and that is games development and games programming. It's easy to see why somebody just getting started in the industry would be interested in working in games. For many people, it's been a passion. Sometimes it's something like myself that drew them into computer science in the first place. It's natural to say, I love this type of thing. I want to work on this thing. It'll make a great career for me. Given that nexus of passion and employment, doesn't it make sense for people to go and pursue their dream of working in the game industry? The answer is not necessarily. Hi, I'm John Miller, the deliberate engineer. I've been a programmer for 40 years, and I worked in big tech at places like Microsoft, Amazon, and Google for 30 of those. I've been a principal engineer, general software engineer, and a software manager, so I've done a lot of different roles at these companies. I developed and released a couple of different games as shareware, and I also worked on a commercial game, Flight Simulator 2002, for Microsoft. I even got a PhD working in computer games, which is to say, I did a PhD in distributed virtual environment security and scalability, with the example case being based on World of Warcraft. I've also been an avid player of games throughout. I got my start on the Magnavox Odyssey in the early 70s, and I've been playing games pretty much daily ever since. Still, in fact, spending a couple hours a day playing whatever my game of the choice is right now. So I'm not just passionate about games, I'm passionate about software engineering, and I'm the sort of person I was talking about before who would take a look and say, oh, what I really want to do is work in games. I still remember teaching myself to program the very first time in BASIC on my friend's Apple II computer, taking a look at the random dungeon generation tables in the back of the Dungeons and Dragons Dungeon Master Guide and learning how to codify that into something that could be used automatically. From that point forward, I played a large number of games and I also worked on games. I mentioned that I released a few things. I also actually quit my job before I went to university and spent 6 or 7 months working on a standalone game that I never finished, but still, I was passionate about it. Even though I am still very passionate about games in general, my experience with the industry and the things that I've seen has made me a lot less excited about going that direction. In fact, at one time I had expected to retire from commercial software development and move instead into making games, and after a year of working side by side with people who'd been in the games industry for a while, I was really talked out of pursuing that. So what I'd like to do for the rest of this video is explain a few basic facts about the game industry and some preconceptions that I think a lot of people who want to go into it have and the reality of what the field's actually like. The first thing to realize is just because you enjoy playing games, it doesn't mean you're going to enjoy making them. The process of making a game is very different from playing it, and it involves a lot of components that are generic or that are unpleasant, sort of boilerplate tasks that don't have anything to do with the play of the game itself or its graphics engine or anything like that. Second, please realize that there's a lot of people who are passionate about games and want to work in them. As a result, there's higher than typical competition for positions as game programmers. The segment of the industry as a whole tends to work harder than average and it tends to be rewarded less than average for most of the people working in it. Add to that the fact that the delivery of games tends to be very seasonal, with a big emphasis on delivering them so that they can be in stores in time for the Christmas rush. And you have a formula set up for an annual tear that can go anywhere from a couple months to half a year. That's a long time to be crunching to make sure that your game gets out. Third, despite the way it may look from the outside, many games never finish, they never ship, and if they do ship, they're not terribly successful. They don't generally make back the cost of producing them. The reason that they're still being made, especially AAA titles, is because when they do work out, when they do pay off, it can pay off quite handsomely. If you're working in games, you have to be prepared for your work to possibly be discarded or relegated by people who just don't appreciate it for whatever reason. There's a lot of different platforms and a lot of different types of game development, especially these days. There's casual games for mobile devices, there's console games, there's PC games, tablet games, and so on. For this discussion, we're not talking about all those different categories. Instead, what we're doing is focusing primarily on the AAA titles that would ship either for a PC or for a console. So for reference, this would include AAA games like Halo, Far Cry, Forza, and so on. AAA games are a huge industry undertaking. You probably don't have an appreciation for this unless you've really paid attention when you've completed a game and looked at the credits that list literally hundreds of people who worked on a variety of aspects of that game. It can include programmers, graphic artists, people working on content, marketing, tools, database administrators, any number of different fields, all working on the same project. It can take anywhere from 2 to 6 years to produce a AAA game, and when you're talking hundreds of employees for 5 years, you're talking literally tens of millions of dollars to make the games. They're incredibly expensive. And as I said earlier, just like the movie industry, if the game happens to be a smash hit AAA title, it can make literally billions of dollars. But a more typical case would be that it has a lot of trouble earning back those tens of millions of dollars that were spent making it in the first place. Now what I'd like to do is spend a little bit more time going over the 3 points that I mentioned earlier. The first one is, just because you enjoy playing games doesn't mean you'll enjoy making them. Now, I usually divide the sets of programmers working on a game into two categories, that is, specialists in game technologies and generalists. The specialists will usually fall into a couple different categories. For example, there might be a real-time specialist. There could be one or two specialists who are focusing on the graphics engine, adapting it to meet the needs and the requirements of the game. And there could be audio engineers who are focused on trying to figure out the right way to have good spatial audio, how to record the data, and so on. In addition to these specialists, there's going to be generalists who are the sort of people you would find working on any sort of project, whether it was a game project or not. You'll have people who work on the content distribution, content delivery pipelines, people working on tools to store things in databases and access them easily, people working on the build tools and that sort of thing, working on being able to reliably stream information to and from whatever the storage devices are, being able to adapt to changes in the particular environment that they're working on, and producing all the tools that people need to be able to do their work. A lot of this is indistinguishable, again, from what you'd be doing in any place that wasn't a game. If your picture of working on a game is that you'll be helping to design levels and come up with characters and have your ideas incorporated into the game, this really isn't very likely to happen for a software engineer, especially one who hasn't shipped games before. Instead, that would typically be handled by a producer or the game designer or a graphic artist or some combination of those. These are all fields that don't really have a whole lot to do with programming, and so it's unlikely a software engineer would be in that field. The second thing I mentioned was that there's very fierce competition for the jobs, and they don't tend to be as well rewarded on average as the same performance would be outside of the games industry. A typical software engineering job at a big tech company, that might be anywhere from 30 to 50 hours of work a week. You go, you take vacations, you just have a normal career. Sometimes you work a little harder, sometimes you don't. You have a regular career progression. If you're talking about working in games, then there's a couple things that are different. First of all, because of the seasonality and because of the high demand for people to want to work in games, the average bar, I feel, is a bit higher in games than it is in the rest of the industry. So the average person that you're working with tends to be better than the average person you'd work with outside of games. That can be a good thing, but it also means that in terms of rewards and promotions and all that, you're competing against the better people. And not just better quality of people, but people who tend to work more. They work harder, they're passionate about what they're doing. So instead of having this 30 hours to 50 hours a week, you might be spending 60 or 70 hours a week just to keep up with the expectations of the position. Now, this will vary a lot from place to place, and especially at the bigger companies, it's possible you'll fall into a role that has more typical software engineering requirements, but this is something you need to be aware of, that the expectations and the bar to meet can be much higher for the same rewards in the gaming industry. The third point I mentioned was it's really easy to work on a game only to have it canceled partway through. This can be for any number of reasons. It can be because the studio that's working on the game is having problems. It could be because the publisher that's going to issue that game and publish it for the console or the PC or whatever, they're having second thoughts either about that direction or they're deciding to work on a competing project with a different team of people. I've seen this happen, it absolutely happens, and it can be heartbreaking. If you're somebody who's been working on a project for years and then your project gets canceled, it's all the more frustrating because you were working harder than you had to, you were spending more time on it, getting paid less than you had to, in the hopes of being able to say that you shipped a game. And now that chance is taken away from you. What can also happen is the funding for the game is typically not done by the people who are actually doing the code and producing the content. As a result, those people probably don't own the intellectual property for that game, unless they can convince another publisher to buy out that intellectual property. The things that they made, they can't do anything with. It's just lost time and effort. And this can be absolutely heartbreaking. This is probably the main thing that talked me out of wanting to work in the games industry. After in the flight simulator team, I worked with several veterans of other game companies who just had these awful horror stories about their project being canceled or the company failing without notice or whatever. If you're working on AA and AAA games, you're probably a little safer because you're probably working for a big company with deep pockets, but it can still absolutely happen. And I, even in my short time in the games industry, I saw projects being canceled at Microsoft. It was less common than it was in the rest of the industry, but it still happened. In summary, games can be a great place to work and fulfill your sort of passion of what you want to do out of your career, but you need to go into it with open eyes. Be aware of the risks and the dangers of how hard you'll have to work. Even if you've shipped games on your own, just like I did, you may find that the experience of doing that as a solo developer or a developer with just a couple of friends is extremely different from what it would be to actually work on a commercial game software team. So don't assume that you know what it's like unless you've actually done it before. One of the best favors you can do for yourself is to find people who are currently working in the game industry or who have worked in the game industry in the sort of environment that you want to work in, and just talk to them. Find out what sort of things they bumped into. Another rich source of information is something called postmortems. It used to be there was an online website called Gamma Sutra. I don't know if it's still around, but there's going to be another site like it. And this would be a place where people who worked on AA and AAA games would write postmortems, discussions about how the project went, what sort of surprises they bumped into, whether it shipped and the game was successful, whether it didn't ship, or whether it shipped and the game was not well received. All of this can really give you a good perspective on the life of somebody working in a game team. So, you know, if you're thinking about doing it, it's worth spending a couple hours going out and looking for postmortems for AA and AAA titles if that's where you're wanting to work. So what I'm trying to say is, even though I'm giving you these sort of awful warnings about games, that's because people tend to be over-enthusiastic with not enough knowledge about what the work is actually going to be like, and they can wind up being disappointed and having a rough patch in their career. Nobody wants that. If you go into it with open eyes, if you're still passionate about working on games and so on, it can absolutely be a great place to work. I've also had friends who worked in games, left for a little while, and then come back and, you know, with sort of a new approach to things, and have worked happily in it for decades. So you can absolutely have a fulfilling, happy career in games. But you have to be realistic about what you're looking for, and you have to be willing to adjust both your expectations and your way of working. But it can still be great. So what do you think? If you've worked on AA or AAA games recently, I'd love to hear your experiences. Mine are a few years out of date. Am I giving an accurate picture of how things look today? Do you have any horror stories or any success stories that you want to share from your own background making games? Or do you think that casual games are really a great place to be? I don't, by the way. I think it's a very rough field because there's so many people working in it, but that's a story for another day. That's all that I have to say today. Thank you very much for watching to the end of the video, and keep on pushing forward. Hi, this is John. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please think about subscribing so you get notified of my future videos. Also, if you are interested, you might want to check out the video I have linked here. Thanks, and keep on pushing forward.